Recorded Books presents When the Angels Left the Old Country by Sacha Lamb. Narrated by Donald Corren. Part 1. When the Angels Left the Old Country. Chapter 1. In the back corner of the little synagogue in the Shtetl that was so small and out of the way it was only called Shtetl, there was a table where an angel and a demon had been studying Talmud together for some 200 years. Indeed, they had been studying in that corner since before the little shul was built, and had been rather startled to look up one day and realize an entire building had sprung up around them. Because the corner they had claimed for their own was close to the door and far from the stove, no one had ever felt it necessary to question their presence. They were always there. There was no reason to assume they would ever not be there. They showed up to study, and sometimes could be seen davening in the back of the shul at Minyan, too, but never when there were fewer than 10 men in the room. One of them never wore a tallis, and the other wore a tallis even during the night, folded over his back like a pair of delicate wings. The demon's name was Ashmedai. He was not the demon king Ashmedai you may have heard of, but one of that Ashmedai's children. The demon king enjoyed an overgenerous measure of self-regard and had named a great number of his children after himself. Perhaps he intended to stymie the angel of death. Perhaps he had trouble thinking of another name. In any case, our Ashmedai was a very minor prince of demons, belonging to that class of creatures and other people might call fairies, and we Jews know as Shadim, mischievous spirits of the earth who enjoy leading people astray. Most of those who knew him did not call him by his full name, but shrank it to fit his stature, and called him Little Ash. Little Ash knew hardly any magic, and did not even have the wings with which most adult demons fly from place to place. He had made trouble in the demons' yeshiva, where they learn their magic, and without completing his studies he had been sent to Poland, where he found he liked it better than at home, as in his father's palace other demons were always treating him like a child and telling him what to do. The angel had been sent to Shtetl for a purpose it had now forgotten, and had stayed in Shtetl to hinder the mischievous whims of Little Ash. Like Little Ash, it resembled a human youth. Unlike Little Ash, who considered himself to be male, the angel had merely chosen the shape of a man for convenience, as angels have done since the time of Abraham, our father. It had never had a bar mitzvah or a bat mitzvah or any such ceremony at all, and had never bothered to wish for one. Its name, of course, changed according to the activity in which it was engaged. At the moment, the angel's name was Argument. "They call it the Golden Land," said Little Ash. "All the young people are going there." "Golden Land," said the angel. "Ashel, I have no interest in gold. Why should I? I find gold excites the Yetzer Hara terribly." "Yetzer Hara, Yetzer Shmara," said Little Ash. "We're not talking about the evil inclination." "You," said the angel, "are always talking about the evil inclination." Little Ash slapped a hand on the table next to the open volume of Talmud. The noise was loud enough to startle the dough goat who was ruminating in the doorway, but not loud enough to startle the old men who were the only others in the shul at the moment. It was a market day, and most of the people of Shtetl had gone to a larger town nearby to earn money for their Shabbos dinners. The men would be home soon for the evening service, bringing the town gossip with them. Little Ash had started the argument with the angel as he usually did. Little Ash, being young and unmarried, preferred the company of young, unmarried people, because he did not understand anyone else, and he found that youth made people particularly open to his mischievous suggestions. Lately, all of the people he liked best had been leaving their shtetl. There were no jobs for Jews in Poland, everyone was saying, but in America they had jobs. In America they had all kinds of wonderful things, according to the papers, and to the gossip Little Ash had heard from those whose families had sent them letters. It was not only that America sounded exciting, although it did. It was also that Shtetl, which had always been small, was even smaller and quieter now. Little Ash was finding it harder to go about his business and was afraid that people would start to notice his presence, and then he would be banished, or else eaten up by one of the Gentile demons from the towns around them, who were always throwing rocks at him and telling him to keep to his own territory. The pogroms in the east had everyone unsettled, always looking over their shoulders. Shtetl was too small to merit that kind of trouble, but if trouble ever came, it was certainly too small to survive it. "I was already listening to whatever you were going to say," said the angel in reproach, taking Little Ash's hand and moving it farther from the sacred pages. There was dirt under the demon's fingernails, and he couldn't be trusted with books. Little Ash slapped the table again with the other hand. "All I'm saying is, if the young people are going to America, oughtn't we go with them? Who will look after them if you don't? Who will foster the Yetzer Tov in the Golden Land for the children of Shtetl if not you? That's all I'm saying." The angel, who suddenly felt as if its name were going to change today, said, "I'm sure they have rabbis in America." This was perhaps too confident on the angel's part, but Little Ash did not have time to mock it, because at this moment there was a noise of boots being knocked clean outside, and all the old men sat up a little straighter, for the rest of the minion had come back from the market. Little Ash, ears keen for gossip, turned around at once and jabbed the angel with a sharp elbow when it kept its eyes on its page of Talmud. "Look, look," he hissed. "It's Samuel the baker. His daughter has gone to America." The angel did not remember who either Samuel the baker or his daughter was, and it only wanted to return to its studies. But it sighed and closed the book, knowing Little Ash wouldn't settle down until the prayers started. The men did not seem close to starting their prayers. The younger ones, who'd just come in, were explaining the news, which could take them quite a while, depending on how the weather and the prices and the road had been, and, of course, depending on whether anyone had run afoul of the Tsar's officials, which could delay the first blessings by nearly half an hour. "I've tried to get word through the agent," Samuel the baker was saying. "Fishel, they call him. He promised he'd taken care of everything, but it's not like Essie not to write." "Did you check the newspapers?" said one of the other men. "There haven't been any ships gone down, have there? God forbid." "There was a notice her ship had come in," said Samuel. "Believe me, I was watching for it." The worried tone of the conversation had finally caught the angel's attention. Our sages tell us that angels only understand Hebrew, the holy language, but our angel, with great effort, had taught itself Aramaic in order to occupy Little Ash by reading Talmud with him. Despite many centuries of exposure to other languages, however, it had never quite been able to wrap its head, or any tongues it happened to possess, around any language that was written with vowels. The men were speaking in Yiddish, and so it did not know what they were saying. "Why are they upset?"
"Essie hasn't written back from America."
"Who is Essie?"
"The baker's daughter. You remember? She used to sit in his lap and he'd read the Talmud to her, before she became a woman and had to go do women's things. Hush, I'm listening."
It seemed, from what the men were now saying, that there had in fact been no word from America, and Essie's last message had been from Warsaw, which wasn't, after all, so far away. She'd met with the immigration agent, Reb Fishel, from Krumer Street, and written her family to say she had her tickets and was to take the train to Hamburg. From there, she should have been in America already. Samuel the baker was now trying, with the help of his friends, to make small numbers bend into the shapes of larger ones in order to convince himself that he could afford to leave his business for a day or two and go to Warsaw himself. No one was keeping score, but if they had been, they would have been able to tell you that Little Ash hardly ever lost an argument with his friend the angel. Of course, as is the nature of these things, it usually turned out that whatever selfish, mischievous, or destructive impulses he put in the hearts of the people he encountered eventually led to new forms of selfless creation. In this case, Little Ash had planted the idea of leaving their village in the head of the angel. When he explained to it what was happening, it took this idea and turned it around, so that it was no longer an idea to go see the world and entertain themselves, but the idea of doing a mitzvah. "Forget America, Ashel," it said. "Tell me how we can go to Warsaw." Chapter 2. Little Ash packed a satchel with his few belongings, and the angel packed nothing, as it owned nothing but the clothes on its back and had never needed anything more than that. For centuries, it had only worn the same white caftan with which it first arrived in Shtetl, but for the occasion of their departure, Little Ash presented it with a vest, a shirt, and trousers, so that it would blend better with the population in the larger towns and cities, where its angelic appearance might draw unwanted attention from Jews and Christians alike. The angel was not used to wearing trousers, but it accepted what Little Ash told it about humans thinking it was terribly old-fashioned to wear a caftan. The angel had always accepted things Little Ash told it about humans and about Christians, as he pretended quite convincingly to be an expert. They caught a ride into town with an old bookseller on his cart, and from town they rode a larger cart belonging to a Gentile peasant who took them to a larger town, and from that town they took a train to the city. Neither of them particularly liked the train, which seemed to them a kind of rude angel who refused to speak to either of them. The train also required tickets. These Little Ash stole from a station attendant, and they would have made it to Warsaw for free had the angel, feeling guilty, not compelled him to buy overpriced kosher sandwiches on the train to make up for it. When they arrived in Warsaw, they were both feeling a bit dizzy from the motion of the train, and were made even more dizzy by the hustle and bustle of the station. The angel had changed its tallis for a plain, undyed woolen shawl that was less conspicuous among the Gentiles, but it felt, once they arrived, that it need not have made the effort, and perhaps could have kept its caftan as well. No one so much as glanced at them. While Ashmedai and the angel are standing on the platform, newly arrived in Warsaw, let us take a moment to look at them. As I mentioned, they both appeared human, for the sake of convenience, but not entirely human. Ashmedai had eyes like a cat's, with vertical pupils, and the angel had eyes like a goat's, with horizontal ones. Ashmedai had feet like a bird, which made his shoes uncomfortable, and the angel had cloven hooves, which did not bother it, because angels are too single-minded to pay attention to their own shapes. These oddities had never given either the angel or the demon any trouble from humans, for it seemed that no one over B'nai Mitzvah age ever noticed these features. As our sages tell us, cherubim have faces like children, and perhaps this angel was one of those because its features were soft and rounded, its face beardless. It had an air of quiet serenity, like a kosher creature ruminating in the sun. Little Ash, bearded also, had sharp elbows, and the way he carried himself suggested that he was always about to go running after something. In their odd way, they were perfect matches for each other, as study partners, chavruses, ought to be. The most important thing to note about their appearance, however, is that they were both unmistakably Jewish. This is why, when a young man detached himself from the crowd, intending to fleece these newcomers, it was a young Jewish man. This young man's name was Yossel. That is, people called him Yossel. It was not the name his parents had given him, nor did it bear anything whatsoever in common with that name. Yossel had a number of reasons for having changed his name, but in doing so, he had proven to himself and the rest of the underworld that he could forge unimpeachable documents for identities that had no history behind them at all. For Little Ash and the Shtetler angel, this was, as one might say, a godsend. Yossel did not know, and indeed had no way of knowing, that the reason he felt compelled to speak to the angel and the demon, out of all the Jews on the platform, was that Little Ash had reached out into the crowd and plucked from the general noise of people's minds the strongest selfish desire he could find. This was one of the little demonic magics that Little Ash was able to do, something that came to demons as easily as speaking languages and hardly counted to them as magic at all. Yossel thought he had spotted a good mark, as both Little Ash and the angel, for very different reasons, looked remarkably fresh and innocent. But it was Little Ash's gentle tug on the thread of his desire that compelled him. In fact, Yossel was the mark, and Little Ash was quite as delighted with the look of him as Yossel was with the look of Little Ash. "How beautiful!" Little Ash said, catching hold of the angel's arm so he could point the newcomer out to it. "Look, he's guilty of more crimes than Jews have obligations." The angel couldn't see that sort of thing on a human's face. What it saw on Yossel's face was that he had reasons for committing his crimes, many of which were perfectly admirable. For instance, Yossel lived with a woman who was, according to her papers, his wife, and she and a woman identified by the law as her sister had, from somewhere, acquired a parcel of children. Someone had to support those children, and at least one-third of the time, that someone was Yossel. Or, ultimately, whomever Yossel chose to fleece. But the angel was a bit short-sighted, as angels usually are, and it tended to miss details that didn't fit into its simple short-term view of the world. Yossel was standing in front of it, and so Yossel was whom it noticed. "What a nice young man," it said. "Nice indeed," said Little Ash, "and he knows the city, too." The angel was not sure how Little Ash knew that, but it supposed he had reserves of demonic knowledge to which it would never have access. Yossel being now in greeting range, the angel said, "Shalom aleichem."
"Aleichem shalom, aleichem shalom," said Yossel,
in the breathless, in-a-hurry way that city people always had. He thrust out a hand for the angel to shake, and the angel shook it.
"First time in Warsaw? Looking for a meal? A minion for prayers? A good kosher house?"
Little Ash insinuated himself between the crook and the angel, grinning up into Yossel's face. Being in the presence of the self-centered and the self-motivated always made Little Ash feel particularly lively, and he wanted to do the talking. Not least because he was aware, as the angel was not, that good kosher house did not necessarily mean here what people claimed it meant in less wicked environs. While the angel, of course, approved of human pleasures, certain complexities of their accomplishment were beyond its understanding. "Good afternoon," the demon said. "Actually, we have a reference from Reb Fischel. He said that in Krumer Street they know a way to get us tickets to America." "In Krumer Street?" said Yossel, drawing himself up indignantly. "In Krumer Street they know nothing. It's nothing but rogues and cheats in Krumer Street." The angel looked down at Little Ash. If it had a name at the moment, that name might have been Concern. It did not understand the conversation, which was taking place in Yiddish, but it did not like the look of what Yossel was saying. Little Ash liked it very much. Demons, backward creatures that they are, love nothing more than dealing with rogues and cheats. In fact, this was precisely how Little Ash made a living for himself, since the job of a small-town demon is a poorly paying one. It seemed to him that if this were the sort of person Essie had gone to for her tickets to America, then Little Ash was the right person to have come after her, and the angel could watch him do what he did best and would perhaps be very impressed with him. "But everyone says the tickets they'll sell you in Krumer Street are the best and the cheapest," he said, making his slit-pupiled gray eyes very big and very innocent. Little Ash had practiced his facial expressions, with the aid of a mirror, so that they projected the trust and naivete of the greenest of pious rural adolescents. He had also been blessed by nature with delicate bones and long eyelashes, which made him look younger than even other demons considered him to be. "Reb Fischel, may his name be trampled in the dust, I mean no disrespect," said Yossel, "is a liar and a dangerous man."
"Oh," said Little Ash, "do you think so?"
"I know so," exclaimed Yossel, throwing a hand in the air as if to chop off the reputation of Fischel from Krumer Street. "They say he's in the pocket of the police and he's had his rivals arrested or killed."
"But then you have to tell us where to find him," Little Ash interrupted. "Reb Fischel was supposed to get tickets for our cousin, and we haven't heard from her at all."
"Your cousin?" Yossel asked. "Are you brothers, then?" He gave the angel a thoughtful look. Yossel was perceptive, and he was wondering if there was more to the angel than met the eye. He knew from experience that it was possible to appear one way and feel quite another, and he had developed a sense for when a person was wearing not only their clothes, but also their body as an ill-fitting garment. Against his own judgment, he could not help feeling somehow protective of such people, and felt uncomfortable at the thought of turning them over to Reb Fischel. "Aren't we all brothers in Israel?" said Little Ash, who didn't care to answer questions about what he and the angel were to each other. "The point is, Essie hasn't written home, and this Fischel will know where she is." Yossel thus began to give them directions, and then, when it became clear that they didn't understand him, turned to lead them, in a state of confusion, to Krumer Street. Chapter 3. Just as in Little Shtetl, many young people were leaving from other towns and cities all across the Pale. One of those cities was Bells, to the south and east of where the angel and the demon had been living. Bells, unlike Shtetl, was large enough to have a name. It also had shops, synagogues, and endless arguments between the local Hasidim and those who considered it the highest mitzvah that they should earn a larger paycheck and eat a little better. One of the latter was a young woman named Rose Cohen, whose father owned a shop but was not good at running it. Rose's father would have been better suited to the work of a melamed, teaching Hebrew to small children, as his favorite way to pass the time was to chant Torah verses in his hoarse, not unpleasant voice, to the goats as he milked them. Mendel Cohen, as he was called, had had the terrible misfortune as a child to be born into a secular family, and as a young man, to inherit a dry goods store. He had had the good fortune, however, to have had a clever daughter. Rose, who was 16 years old, and had been told more times that she was unladylike than that she was pretty, had a head for numbers and a mouth for bargaining, and one day, when she was 15, she had read in a newspaper a published advertisement from a steamship company, which had explained with solid mathematics the practicality of going to America. This had, of course, been meant as an enticement to migrants to buy their tickets from that steamship line, but Rose had taken it as a challenge. She would, she had decided, save up the money to take herself to America, and her best friend Dinah Pearl besides, and between the two of them, they would grow rich and buy tickets for their families to come after them, and none of their younger brothers would ever have to go into the army. Of younger brothers, Dinah had a whole flock, and Rose had only the one, Mottl, whose safety she kept as a priority because, unlike any other boy in all of Bells, he admired her. Not that Rose needed admiration from boys. She knew her own merit better than anyone else, as she reminded herself nearly every day, whenever someone asked her to speak more quietly, or perhaps a little less, or tried to tell her it wasn't a young woman's business to be demanding the overdue payment for the sack of tobacco she'd sold them months before on credit. Never mind what anyone said, Rose knew herself to be the cleverest girl in town, and when one was the cleverest, one needn't be the prettiest. Which was lucky, because the prettiest girl in town was Dinah, anyway. Dinah Pearl, with the big dark eyes of a doe and the fine, delicate hands of a seamstress fit to make the prettiest lace from the softest thread. Dinah Pearl, whose unruly tumble of younger brothers seemed always on the edge of starvation, their grandfather's reputation as a miracle worker bringing in strangely little in the way of food. Dinah, who had been Rose's best friend since the two of them had barely learned to talk, and who had never once told Rose that she was getting ahead of herself. No one in the world, in Rose's opinion, had quite so many virtues as Dinah. It was for these reasons that she had decided she would take Dinah to America with her. Two young women together would be safer than one alone in any case, and Dinah would never think to leave if Rose didn't push her. She was the sort of person who would be content to sit by the fire in her own little house forever, gently stirring a pot of soup while she repaired her brother's little trousers and warmed up the water for their baths. Dinah had never once complained about such a life, but Rose knew it wasn't good enough. In America, Dinah could have dresses, nice dresses, for herself that someone else had sewn. And she could buy sandwiches for her brothers instead of always eating soup, and she could go to dance halls. At least, Rose had heard that in America they had dance halls, and when she got there, she intended to take Dinah with her to confirm that it was true. Dinah had no way to earn money for a steamship ticket, but this was no obstacle for Rose Cohen. The day after she had read that advertisement in the paper, Rose had gone out to the back of the pasture behind the Cohen house, where her father was chanting a portion of Torah under his breath as he piled green branches for the goats to nibble on. "Papa," she said, "did you know that the account books in the shop haven't been updated since the High Holy Days?" "Hmm?" said her father. "Oh, Rose, is there someone in the shop?" Mendel Cohen, as his wife was often saying, was a kind man and a good one, but his ears were no good at all.
I've been thinking, Rose said, that it would make sense for me to do all the accounts, and we could hire Dinah to sit behind the counter and help people measure their weights and take the payments. I think everyone would be happier to give money to Dinah than to just about anyone in the world.
Ah, said Mendel.
This he understood, as it had something of the flavor of tzedakah, that form of financial justice that is commanded upon us in Torah. Dinah's family had nothing, and the Cohens had a shop. So should not Dinah have some part in the shop to keep her going?
That's my clever daughter, he said. You do whatever you like.
Rose smiled and kissed her father's cheek and left him to finish his verses. She went to the shop and took out the account books, and then she went down to the street to the Pearls and told them she'd like to hire Dinah to smile at customers and make sure they found what they were looking for. And then she and Dinah went back to the shop, where Dinah sat quietly behind the counter and mended tiny pairs of trousers, while Rose checked sums and made a list of delinquent payments and waited for her brother Mortal to get back from Cheder so she could hire him as a messenger. The dry goods shop did better with Rose in charge than it had under her father's distracted leadership. People found that the shelves were restocked and cleaned more frequently, and they mostly didn't mind as much that it was harder to buy things on credit, because at least the requests for money came from the lovely, smiling mouth of Dinah Pearl, who was, after all, the sister of a truly astonishing number of hungry little boys. With Mottle carrying packages, it was easier for the elders to make purchases, and Rose carefully divided the money into piles. For the shop, for Mottle and her parents, for Dinah's family, for America. America was hungry for money, and there was a whole list of expenses. Travel papers, to prove they were allowed to leave Russia and then to enter America, steamship tickets, train tickets to get to the ship, food for the journey, and a little extra because Rose believed in being prepared. Rose kept all the papers in the back of her father's account book, and the money she kept in the goat shed, where no one but Mendel would ever find it, and Mendel could be trusted not to touch it. He considered his daughter a genius, particularly since her efforts in the shop had allowed him to buy, once in a while, some rabbinic text for himself for the edification of the goats while he repaired his fences. Rose ran the shop in this way for a year, during which she also made regular visits to the Jewish Immigration Bureau, where she picked up pamphlets and newspapers to read while she sat in the back of the shop in between doing the accounts. When there were no customers coming in the door, she would join Dinah at the counter, and the two of them dreamed together of all the things that one could do in America. Dinah was not such a hungry reader as Rose, but she liked to look at the advertisements in the newspapers and think about how in America there would be feathers for hats, and perhaps it would not be so shocking for a girl to wear a red dress in the street. Dinah was self-conscious of her taste for fashion, which seemed to her unthrifty and therefore somehow selfish, but Rose assured her every day that she had the right to a little selfishness. And she had the right to be pretty. After all, it was her pretty face that made people so happy to visit the Cohen shop.
That's true, said Dinah, blushing on one occasion when Rose mentioned this. But, Rose, it feels awfully embarrassing to say so.
Everyone in the world has talents, said Rose. You shouldn't be ashamed that you're the loveliest girl in the Pale of Settlement.
Oh, Rose, said Dinah.
Dinah found herself saying, "Oh, Rose," about 100 times a week. Rose had always been the wild one, which was what Dinah loved most about her. But at the same time, it was a little frightening. Dinah was not as sure as Rose was that it would be a wonderful adventure to cross an ocean and leave everything behind. Dinah, after all, had more brothers than Rose did, and was perhaps a little more attached to them. Rose's brother, Mortal, was only a few years younger than herself. Not so little that Rose had cared for him his whole life. And besides, he was at an age where boys become terribly rude to their sisters if they aren't watched closely. Another reason for Dinah's worries, as she sat and chatted with Rose about the life the two of them would have across the sea, was that among the people who had been visiting the Cohen shop in hopes of glimpsing Dinah's face, there was one young man whose face she found she liked just as much as he liked hers. She tried not to bring him up too frequently in conversation because Rose, perhaps out of some unconscious resentment toward her irresponsible father,
had a habit of dismissing at once the merit of any young man who seemed likely to become a Torah scholar. And the boy Dinah loved was not only likely but certain to become a scholar, as he was a disciple of one of the Hasidic Rebbes on their end of town, an old man with a bad leg and a reputation for working miracles. Dinah's life had not had enough miracles in it, and when she looked at this young man, she saw in his eyes the suggestion that she herself was also a miracle. Rose also looked at her this way, but Dinah had not noticed. Chapter 4 Little Ash explained the situation to the angel in Aramaic as Yossel led them away from the train station. Unlike angels, demons are quite gifted with languages. Although Little Ash, for reasons known only to himself, had adopted a Yiddish accent in all languages around the time of the false Messiah in the reign of Tsar Alexis Mikhailovich. The angel used a certain vague sense of superiority to excuse itself its failure to communicate with humans. What did anyone need to speak of, it sometimes thought, that could not be said in holy words? Nevertheless, it also considered itself too generous to be annoyed by Little Ash's accent or by the demon's insistence on speaking in modern jargon while in public. It now realized that not speaking in modern jargon might be a problem if it wished to speak to modern people, to find Essie and bring her home to her worried family, which is what it thought they had come to do, having half forgotten that she was meant to be on the other side of an ocean. "So he is helping us," it said now, "because he is a good Jew." "He certainly is," said Little Ash. "He is helping us find the man who sold Essie her papers for America."
"I don't understand all this paper," said the angel.
Angels are easily distracted, and it was feeling thoughtful as it squinted at the advertisements and playbills that were pasted to the walls of the nearby buildings. The angel could remember a time when one hardly ever saw paper. As far as it could remember, that had been practically yesterday. It could not read any alphabet other than the Hebrew one, and was particularly fascinated with the advertisements in Gentile writing. Had it not known that if it lost sight of Little Ash, it might forget its purpose in coming to Warsaw, it might have stopped to puzzle over the illustrations. Little Ash was not particularly interested in angelic ruminations. Keeping half an eye on the angel, just in case it should wander off, he took a couple of quick steps to catch up with Yossel.
"You said we can do better than Reb Fischel? Do you get a lot of business for America these days?" he asked.
"Oh, America, Canada, Cuba," said Yossel, waving a hand with a worldly air. "I know all the Americas."
"Is it true what they say, that all the young people forget the commandments in America?"
Little Ash's eyes were shining. The angel, had it been paying the least bit of attention, might have chided him for sounding so hopeful. Yossel, who was himself, by most definitions, a young person, and who had forgotten any number of commandments, glanced back at the angel. It seemed to him that the quieter of his two new clients might be the sort of person who disapproved of forgetting commandments. Should he say no?
"Don't worry," said Little Ash. "My friend speaks only the holy language. You can be honest."
"Only?" Yossel was impressed, despite himself. "Now that's what they call a pious Jew."
"They say in America they have dance halls on every corner," said Little Ash.
Although he considered himself something of a radical, he liked to read the Orthodox papers because he found they detailed a great deal more misbehavior than the others. Socialists and so forth seemed to find more good in the hearts of humankind than did the pious writers, and so it was to the conservatives that Little Ash turned when he wanted to feel a dose of optimism. Yossel would have liked to tell tall tales, but with the specter of his rival Reb Fischel hanging over him, he felt compelled to deliver a measure of honesty.
"In Warsaw, too, they have dance halls," he said, a little reluctantly.
The demon looked down at his feet, which were, as usual, feeling a bit sore from walking on the earth. Perhaps if the streets of America were paved with gold, as the wilder storytellers like to claim, he wouldn't have such trouble. But he had a suspicion that those stories were entirely invented. "In any case," Little Ash said, "I imagine America isn't less sinful than Poland."
"Oh, no," Yossel agreed.
He wasn't sure what Little Ash was trying to imply.
"I imagine not. I suppose..."
Yossel tended to save his creativity for his forgeries and not for meditations on the nature of the world, but he stretched his mind as best he could.
I suppose in the end, the whole world is more or less full of sin.
For the next 3 minutes or so, all three were quiet. Yossel and Little Ash were contemplating the forger's philosophy of the world. The angel was contemplating an advertisement for tooth whitening powder, the wording of which had stretched the limits of the Hebrew alphabet as far as Little Ash's questions about morality had stretched the mind of Yossel the forger.
"Well, in any case," said Yossel, "you'll want to find me again as soon as you've heard from Reb Fishel about your cousin. Don't stay by him a minute longer than you must. He eats Shtetl Jews alive, Reb Fishel. You must understand."
Little Ash simply smiled. He had no intention of being eaten alive. Yossel, seeing the smile on what he mistakenly thought was an innocent face, felt terribly uncomfortable and was glad when they came to the corner of a street with a sharp twist in it like a broken bone.
"Since it's Friday night," he said, "I suppose he'll be at the synagogue. I've heard he does business there."
"Business?" said Little Ash, still smiling. He turned to the angel and said, "We are going to a synagogue." "Oh," said the angel, and blinked at him, confused. It usually had to argue Little Ash around to attending prayers, and was not sure why he looked so pleased with himself.
"It's just down that way," said Yossel, pointing.
He was not the sort of Jew who went to synagogue, whether to do business or otherwise, and in any case, he did not wish to show his face in Krumer Street, where he had on occasion been threatened with having his nose kicked in. Nor did he wish to see the poor, naive village boys, Little Ash and the Angel, have their noses kicked in. He was already backing away from them, taking small steps. Neither of them paid him much attention. The Angel had caught the scent of the approaching Sabbath in the air, and Little Ash, like a terrier, had caught the scent of a rat. Inside the little synagogue on Krumer Street, it was quite crowded and quite loud. It seemed a good portion of the Jewish quarter had come here this evening, most of them for gossip rather than prayer. A good number of the people in the room were liars and schnorrers and cheats, this being one of those poor neighborhoods in which the quickest way to fill one's mouth, and indeed often the only way, was to become a liar and a cheat. The Tsar's laws had only made this more true, and business in Krumer Street was busy indeed. Little Ash, even with his keen eyes and ears, could scarcely keep track of all the sins and violations going on around him. The angel was oblivious to this. Its name was now Myriv, as its thoughts turned without conscious effort to the evening prayers. It could see only holiness in a synagogue, and was quite unaware that to many of the men surrounding it, God was a distant and untrustworthy ruler, hardly more beloved than the Tsar himself. Even before the prayer leader began his chanting, the angel Myriv was focused on its task, already singing praises in a tone inaudible to human ears, which, nevertheless, produced in everyone who felt it a strange sense that everything around them was both more real and more miraculous than it had previously been. Little Ash, meanwhile, glanced around and surreptitiously removed his shoes, which, after a day of travel, were beginning to hurt him terribly. Should the angel notice, he had an excuse prepared. While in the palace of his father Ashmedai for Yom Kippur, he would explain, his brother, also called Ashmedai, but Ash Kutty for short, as he lived in India, had told everyone that in his shul in Chendamangalam they did not wear shoes to worship. Little Ash felt this would be an excellent excuse, and he was a bit disappointed when the angel, otherwise engaged, declined to notice him at all. Thus having made himself more comfortable, and with his study partner paying him no attention, the demon looked around the room with interest. Little Ash liked being among people. He never ceased to be amazed at their capacity for hopping the fences around the Torah and trampling the commandments beneath their feet. While the angel's inaudible singing made even the motes of dust which fell from the ceiling seem as precious as jewels in the crown of the Tsarina, may her name be erased, Little Ash's hungry eyes counted a minion of hypocrites, another of scoundrels, and several minions worth of broken promises. The angel, unhindered by the pace of the congregation, had already reached its Amidah halfway through the service, while the rest were only starting on the Kaddish that marked the beginning. This would cause no trouble, however, because the Amidah of angels is, in their homeland, ceaseless and endless, and even in exile it could last them a long time. Little Ash tucked one foot behind the other knee, and thus, fulfilling the tradition of praying on a single foot, continued not to actually pray. One face in particular on the other side of the room had caught his attention. This face would put on a pious attitude when that would profit it, but only then. This was someone who, in his heart, held no regard for anything of benefit to anyone but himself. The person Little Ash was looking at, a veritable well of wickedness, was quite tall for a Jew and well-muscled, with a rather attractive, healthy face. However, to the eyes of a demon, all of his handsomeness was wasted, as little creatures seemed to crawl over his skin like ants, creatures which, upon closer inspection, would prove to be built of little tangles of Hebrew letters that detailed all of his sins. To the eyes of a demon, these sins revealed all of the lives this man had destroyed to get to where he was, which was, incidentally, quite a comfortable place. He had, in fact, Little Ash noticed with interest, not just destroyed lives through the usual disregard for any and all of the 613 commandments, but had even destroyed a number of them directly by disregarding the sixth. The sixth commandment, as you know, once broken, cannot be unbroken or forgiven. Little Ash was aware that the man he was looking at knew this, and had, all the same, contrived to disobey this commandment on more than one occasion. Anyone who had looked at Little Ash in that moment could have been forgiven for thinking his eyes were purely black. He had, like a cat spotting a mouse, focused so intensely on his target that his irises had entirely been swallowed up by his pupils. Though other demons saw Little Ash as rather pitiful, as his lack of talent for magic made him rather less dangerous than most of his kind, he still knew suitable prey when he saw it, and he was not afraid to go hunting. The mouse, or I should say the murderer, was called Reb Fishel, the silk merchant. Chapter 5. Reb Fishel, although he did not know it, had just solved a problem for the demon. Little Ash was not thinking of Essie, as it was not in his habit to think of others. He was merely thinking of the problem of how to get himself and the angel to America, a goal he had not given up. To get to America, one needed papers, which would need to be forged, as neither of them had a legal identity. Then they had to go to Germany, and from Germany board a ship, and after the ship, Ellis Island. The angel, like all angels, required no more sustenance than the presence of God's holiness, but Little Ash needed to eat, or else he could starve and die, as a human would. As he thought himself too excellent to be wasted by dying, he therefore needed at least one meal daily. So there was food, which the angel would insist he pay for honestly. And everyone knew that, to get out of Russia, a Jew often needed to bribe the officials at the border. In short, even had there been no Essie, Little Ash needed more money than he had, and Reb Fishel had more money than Little Ash had, and they would, in a way, be helping each other. Reb Fishel would help the demon get to America, and Little Ash would help the murderer remember his commandments. Myriv, the angel, beside him, had reached the 360th of its 18 blessings and would still be praying for a while. Satisfied for the moment working through the details of a plan in his head as he would untangle the meaning of a sentence in Talmud, Little Ash looked away from Reb Fishel and took the chance to enumerate some blessings of his own. When the leader opened up the ark for the Aleinu prayer, Little Ash slipped out from between the standing men and climbed the narrow steps at the back of the room. These led to the women's gallery that looked ready to collapse at any moment, having been affixed to the interior wall by an indifferent carpenter long enough ago that the steps were worn smooth, although how any woman dared place her weight on them was anyone's guess. The carpenter would have served the community better by building the mechitza to divide male from female on solid ground, Little Ash thought. But it served his own purposes at the moment because he wanted to be closer to the rafters. No one noticed Little Ash, and indeed, even had there been women in the women's gallery that day, which there were not, They would not have seen anything amiss if they had looked at him. He had remembered Essie on the way up the stairs, and now wore what he recalled of her shape. Little Ash's most reliable magic, aside from plucking the selfish thoughts out of human heads for his own perusal and amusement, was the ability to change his shape to make himself less conspicuous. Even this was limited. He remained the same size, no matter how much he might try to make himself taller. Fortunately, however, at the moment he did not need to be taller, and only wanted to be sure that no one should look up and suspect him of impropriety. The reason Little Ash wanted to be closer to the rafters is that the congregation's sinful ghosts, who had been released from Gehinnom for the day of rest, were up there, clinging to the high parts of the room. A ghost is a creature that tends to grasp whatever surface it can find, as an infant will try to grasp any object it is given. Because ghosts are very light, they have a tendency to float upward on currents of warm air. They clustered, therefore, on the rafters, which was just as well, because there wouldn't have been room for them down below, the shul, as I have said, being quite crowded. Most demons do not speak to ghosts. They consider ghosts to be rather beneath them. As demons are, albeit in a sideways, backward, or upside-down way, lower orders of B'nai Elohim, and ghosts are merely remnants of the children of Abraham. Our father, while of course an eminent ancestor, does not quite measure up, in the opinion of most demons, and ghosts tend to be preoccupied with a very limited set of concerns, none of which demons, with their superior talents in magic, can put to much use. Little Ash, however, considered himself a socialist, and it was without qualm that he chose to lower himself, metaphorically if not physically, to the prospect of a conversation with these unfortunates. He was looking for the souls of those Reb Fishel had killed. He hoped Essie was not among them, but Little Ash had some experience with murderers and had found, on many occasions, that the names of their victims disquieted them. The more details he could discover about their deaths, the more he could rely on words to do his work for him, and the less he would need to rely on miracles, or worse still, on physical confrontation. Little Ash's scanty magic was no good for fighting. As for winning arguments by the strength of his arm, let us not humiliate him with details, but only note that of the two divine creatures from Shtetl, the angel could have thrown a more respectable punch if sufficiently provoked. Cleverness, therefore, was Ash's best weapon. As the demon had expected, there was a knot of little ghosts, huddled together like bats, on the thickest rafter beam in the middle of the room. He leaned somewhat precariously over the balcony railing and hissed to get their attention. The ghosts rustled and squeaked in consternation. They had not been expecting anyone to address them, for the very good reason that no one ever had. They really were like a lot of bats. Little Ash supposed it had something to do with habitat. Perhaps, being stuck to the ceiling, they found they couldn't help but develop leathery wings to complement their little grasping fingers. Or else it was some deep ancestral memory that caused humans to lose their shapes and change to something more like other mammals when they died. "Shalom Aleichem, ghosts," said the demon. "Is there someone among you called Essie, the baker's daughter, from a shtetl that doesn't have a name? And which of you has a grudge against Reb Fishel down there, the tall one from Krumer Street?" He had been expecting a response of some kind, but he was quite startled when all of the ghosts began to shout at once. The angel had been approaching 4,000 blessings in the Shimon Esra and had not noticed that Little Ash was no longer standing beside it. When the ghosts began to speak, however, it found itself transformed, with inconvenient suddenness, from Myrav to startled. Blinking at the space where it expected the demon to be, it realized that he was not there. And then it saw also that he had left his shoes behind. Only after noting these facts did the angel think to wonder what it was that had startled it in the first place. Oh yes, it must be that, in addition to the gossip of living humans, who had concluded their last Kaddish and were catching each other up on the vital news of the last 12 hours, there was now a second layer of conversation in the shul. On that layer, there was a great deal of shouting. The angel could not, at first, make out any of the details, but with the wisdom of experience, it assumed that Little Ash must somehow be responsible. which meant, in a way, that the angel itself was responsible. It put away its prayer book, picked up its chavrusa's shoes, and went to see what was happening. Chapter 6 Rose and Dinah had been saving for America for 1 year, from New Year to New Year, and then for another 6 months into the spring again, after Dinah had to scrape together to help pay for her grandfather, the lame Rebbe of Bells, to travel to America and see his daughter, Dinah's aunt, who was getting married and needed his blessing. Now Passover had passed over, and Rose, sitting with her pocket notebook in the goat paddock, found herself underlining a number she had calculated herself out of all the newspapers and pamphlets she had read. She had the money for America. They could buy tickets and leave whenever they wanted. She sat for quite some time, staring at the number. She found it very difficult to believe that her plan had really worked, but the weight of the cash box she kept hidden in the hay was quite convincing. She had everything else she needed. Papers for herself and for Dinah, an extra quilt so she wouldn't be cold on the journey, even a new pair of boots so she wouldn't have to buy them in America. Yet she felt as if there must be something she had missed, something so enormous that it would make everything she had done mean nothing at all. All of her lists added up, there couldn't be anything. What could there possibly be? She did the calculations again, just in case, and came up with the same answer. Then she sat in silence, trying to compose the perfect speech to give Dinah to explain that it was time to move forward, until Mendel Cohen came in with the goats, and one of the does came over to Rose and ripped the page of numbers out of her notebook to chew on.
"Ah," said Mendel quietly, "she is hungry for knowledge."
"Papa," said Rose in a faraway, shocked voice, "we have enough for tickets."
For a long moment, Mendel said nothing. It seemed he found it no easier to believe than Rose had. Finally, he said,
"That's my Rose. Blessed be the God who gives men daughters."
For some reason, this made Rose burst into tears, and she jumped up to give her father a hug. Her tears brought tears to his eyes in turn, and they stood there for several minutes, hugging each other and crying, before Mendel suggested they ought to go back to the house and let Rose's mother and little Martel know that Rose would soon be in America and they would soon be rich. Rose's mother, Panina, cooked a chicken soup with dumplings to celebrate, as if it were Shabbos, making enough so that the Pearls could come over and eat with the Cohens. Rose helped her knead the dough, excusing her reluctance to talk to Dinah by the thought that she ought to present the news with real ceremony, the way one would announce an engagement, almost. She ought to have a beautiful speech to give. Dinah deserved only the most beautiful things. Details, numbers, boring things, those were all for Rose to take care of, so that Dinah didn't have to. Besides, she was terribly nervous, and pummeling the dough helped her feel less like a bird trapped in a basket, fluttering pointlessly at the walls. She was a grown woman, she told herself, and a grown woman ought to act dignified. If she ran over to Dinah's house at once, she knew she would slam her way through the front door and find herself screaming in her most high-pitched tones, jumping up and down, and possibly even crying. She wanted to present a more responsible picture to the Pearls, in case Dinah's mother worried about sending Dinah to America with only Rose for company. Dinah's mother, as much as Dinah, needed to believe that Rose could keep her daughter safe. After all, they had heard hardly anything from Dinah's aunt in that country, and the last letter from the Rebbe had come from Warsaw, where he had stopped to meet some colleagues before taking the train to Hamburg. No one would say it, but God forbid it was possible he had become ill on the journey, or lost, or the great holiness of his person had not protected him from such mundane and worldly things as government officials and thieves.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.